FreeSchool 101.
Of all the astronomical objects in space, none are more widely recognized than stars. Stars are the building blocks of galaxies, responsible for the formation of heavy elements and tied to the fate of planetary systems that develop around them. You may be surprised to learn that although they look similar to the naked eye, stars are as varied as anything else in the universe. Studying the types, age, and composition of stars can help us learn the history of the galaxies they are in. And to assist with this, we can classify stars in many different ways. One of the first things that early astronomers realized when studying the stars was that some of them are brighter than others. This may have seemed like a good method to use to classify stars, but it has a major problem that might already be obvious to you. Just like a flashlight that is farther away will seem dimmer than an identical one that is closer, if two stars of equal brightness are at different distances from Earth, one will appear brighter and one will appear dimmer than the other. With the development of telescopes, it became easier to see that stars glowed in different colors: blue, white, yellow, orange, and red. But the boundaries between visible colors can be subjective, so that wasn't quite enough to sort them into universally agreed-upon categories. It was the invention of spectroscopy that really revolutionized stellar classification. Spectroscopy, or breaking up light into individual wavelengths, began with Isaac Newton's experiments with prisms, where he demonstrated that ordinary sunlight was made up of all the colors of the rainbow. Later, scientists realized that there were gaps in the sun's spectrum which appear as dark lines. Further investigation revealed that other stars also had black lines missing from their spectra, but in different places. These black bands are called absorption lines. Absorption lines occur when gas in the outer layer of stars absorbs some of the light emitted by them. By matching the patterns of absorption lines with those from known elements, astronomers were able to learn more about the chemical composition of stars. They realized that stellar spectra seemed to fall into several distinct patterns and began to group stars with similar patterns together. Amateur astronomer Henry Draper began the work of photographing stellar spectra in 1872, and following his death in 1882, Edward Pickering continued it at the Harvard College Observatory. The Draper catalog of stellar spectra was published in 1890, classifying more than 10,000 stars by assigning them letters from A through O based on the strength of their hydrogen lines. Much of the work of classifying these thousands of stellar spectra was done by a group of women called the Harvard Computers. Before computer machines, of course, a computer was a person who performed computations, calculations, and data analysis. One of these women, named Annie Jump Cannon, proposed a simpler method of classifying stars by their surface temperature, combining categories until there were only 7 left. Since no one wanted to redo the classification that had already been done, the original letter categories were kept, but rearranged into a seemingly random order: OBA, FGK, and M. Fortunately, Annie Jump Cannon also created a mnemonic to help remember them. O, be a fine guy, or girl, kiss me. This new classification system was called the Harvard system. Under the Harvard system, O-type stars are the hottest, and M-type stars are the coolest. Our sun is a G-type star, near the middle. Of course, there is much more to classifying stars than temperature or color. Let's take a look at something called the Hertzsprung-Russell Diagram, or the HR diagram for short. The HR diagram is a scatter plot of stars that allows us to sort them by brightness or luminosity and temperature. As you can see, there is a correlation between temperature and color, as well as size and luminosity. The majority of stars belong to something called the main sequence. Stars on the main sequence are fusing hydrogen in their cores to form helium during the longest phase of their life cycle, and account for about 90% of all known stars. If you observe the main sequence on the HR diagram, you can see that stars fall in a diagonal line from the top left to the lower right. Stars at the top left are hotter and brighter, and stars at the bottom right are dimmer and cooler. Stars that have depleted their hydrogen cores develop into giants or supergiants, visible in the HR diagram above the main sequence. Their cores contract, creating enough heat and pressure to trigger fusion of heavier elements, and their outer layers expand to many times the star's original size. Due to their massive size, giant stars are many times more luminous than the Sun, even if they are cooler on the surface. Once a giant star has exhausted all possible fusion reactions in its core, it's off to the next phase of its life. Smaller stars like our Sun will expel their outer layers and leave a dense, dim, slowly cooling core called a white dwarf, visible in the lower left of the HR diagram. White dwarfs are extremely hot when originally formed, but as they have no means of producing additional energy, they will cool and darken over time, eventually becoming a black dwarf, a dense lump made mostly of carbon that emits neither heat nor light. Now let's discuss a few types of stars that do not appear on the HR diagram. A supergiant at the end of its lifespan may explode in a supernova and produce either a black hole, which is not a star at all, or a small, superdense body called a neutron star. Neutron stars are composed mostly of densely packed neutrons and have incredibly strong magnetic fields. Though many neutron stars are undetectable due to the fact that they are not emitting very much radiation, a special type of neutron stars called pulsars are the exception. Pulsars are rapidly spinning neutron stars that emit beams of electromagnetic radiation out of their poles. This radiation is only detectable at certain positions in the pulsar's rotation, and as it spins, the beam disappears and reappears at regular intervals. These pulses of radiation gave pulsars their name. Finally, let's talk about brown dwarfs. Technically not stars, brown dwarfs are classified as substellar objects. They are sometimes referred to as failed stars because they did not accumulate enough mass to jumpstart nuclear fusion of hydrogen into helium. Brown dwarfs are much more massive than gas giants, but may be smaller than the planet Jupiter because they are more dense. Although brown dwarfs have comparatively low surface temperatures and do not emit much in the way of visible light, they do emit in the infrared wavelengths. As you can see, the answer to the question, how are stars classified, is complicated. The Sun is classified as a G-type main sequence star, but it is also referred to as a yellow dwarf. Stars can be classified by their color, size, brightness, spectra, or phase in their life cycle. All of this is an attempt to understand and quantify the things that make stars different from each other and understand how they relate to the larger universe. As with so much out there in space, there is more to a star than meets the eye.